I thought he's casual. I'm like, you can
do no. Do shadow puppets.
Zombie shadow puppets.
I know one shadow puppet.
Okay, maybe not that one.
We can look on real
quick. Okay, now you see it says start strumming. So you're going to go to...
So now you want it.
Okay, now, what's important, very important, don't press that.
Don't press. Stop streaming.
I do that at night after you guys are done at 10 p.m.
Okay.
You just never know it.
Okay.
Okay, you're live. So we're in the live control room. View on watch page.
So go up to view on watch page.
Yeah.
God, it's like 43 steps to this piece.
They can hear everything.
Okay. We're upper right.
Yeah.
Okay. Usual.
There we go.
Like Eric's little guy.
The people
watching. Okay. So, I need to hit record up there in a minute.
Yes.
Okay, so then.
Okay, so now I'm going to come in here just saying.
Okay, one for model. Yeah. Get ready.
Can you call me?
So I just added a comment. So your comments are just on the right. Nobody's left a comment. Just so you know, and you can remind these guys that that's live now. So everything we're saying, people can hear, which is good. And so we're just waiting for her to go. You can see right now that many people are more.
People are asking,
they
can ask questions or ask questions. Can you introduce yourself?
I mean, we'll just wait 5 minutes.
It's
going to
be about 5 minutes.
About 5 minutes? Okay, so we can leave a comment on there saying that about five more minutes.
Let me make sure I have all my...
They just seem like it took a little longer than they thought. But it posted something 2 hours ago, and it already looked cool, so...
It's going to look even cooler.
Yeah, I would imagine.
Okay, so here's all my notes.
So that's why I double check on a separate computer just to make sure.
I almost just deleted it because I thought it was just a spam. I have a lot of those for horror films. Well, I'm on a lot of like horror forums, and so I think I just get on there. Knoxville Horror Film Festival. I've never heard of it.
Somebody wants to know if you have a real zombie in the studio.
We will. He's shambling in as we speak.
Yeah. So this is where it's cool to just keep things going by putting comments.
He's a slow moving type of zombie, so running away.
As opposed to World War Z.
Yeah.
Or the Dawn of the Dead remake, which I thought was really cool. Mm-hmm. They worked in that. Yeah. They were sprinters in that movie, but.
There are 68 people watching.
I'm
watching nothing.
Yeah,
we're not going to open up that back door, actually.
We have zombie.
Yes, you do. With glasses.
So what are you thinking? Something kind of like that.
Okay.
And if you need to shake out the arms from time to time, you can do that.
Cool.
So, but, you know, just something with the hands kind of gnarled up.
Okay. Yeah.
Sweet.
Okay, so Eric, while you're introducing yourself, I'm going to take a shot of Yoni.
Okay.
And so we're good to go.
So should I just say, just sit,
welcome.
Should I just sit there?
Yeah.
Okay. Do I look at the camera or?
No, you can just start talking.
Okay, so we're about to get started here. I'm Erik Gist, and I'm going to be doing a undead drawing tonight from the live model. And Yoni is our model, and he also does prosthetics and makeup work, so he actually got in full zombie makeup. Maybe switch the hands? So, yeah.
Can you show this?
Yeah, there you go. Maybe group them a little bit more together. Yeah, there you go. More like that. There you go. Cool. And then head up just a little bit. Maybe down just a little bit more. Yeah, perfect. Awesome. And like I said, if you need to rest the hands at some point, you can just shake them out.
Okay, so,
So now we got Yoni set up, and we're going to give you a shot of him real quick here so you can see what I'm working from. Okay, I just did, I guess. Maybe a little bit to your left. Turn your head a little bit to your left. A little bit more. And then gaze back towards me. There you go. Perfect. Awesome. Okay, so I'm going to be drawing mostly upper body here, and so we'll be focusing pretty much from the waist up, and I'm going to take what's up there, which looks awesome. It's not going to require much enhancement. I thought I was going to have to do a little bit more zombifying on the drawing, so it's going to make my job a lot easier here. So when I'm starting the drawing, I'm going to start by establishing the parameters of the drawing. Just looking for the big picture, just trying to get everything established. I always like to work from big shapes down to small shapes, and so that's what I'm after right now, just getting the big shapes of the drawing set up. Looking at things like spatial relationships, negative shapes, rhythmical relationships, comparative measurement, all those things. Plumb lines, just getting everything spaced and placed where it's supposed to go. That's looking pretty good as far as fitting on the page overall. Head size maybe looks a little bit on the small side. So I'll take just a quick measurement. Okay, so that looks pretty good there. And then just start approaching my center of interest and get the construction and two-value block in there. Allowing myself a little bit of time to get warmed up. and just keep things really simple here in the beginning and build towards complexity later on in the drawing. Set a timer. I don't think we set a timer.
Yeah. Should I do it for like 15 minutes from now?
Yeah, that's fine. So decent linear lay-in for the head at this moment, and so I'll move on and start getting the linear lay-in for the rest of the figure before starting to move into tones. I probably won't get too into the folds of the jacket this early on. I'll wait till I work on those individual areas to get too specifically into them, but for right now I'll just keep it really loose. Thank you. The hands also I'll keep a little bit simpler for right now, and then I'll have him pose the hands a little more specifically as I get to each hand. And that's pretty much how I would also handle it if I were doing an illustration. I'll get the big general shot of the model, and then and then I'll zoom in on each individual area and get a few different variations on it, and then pick and choose what I like best.
Hey Jeff, I'm gonna put up the photo myself.
Okay, so now I'm gonna get back up to the top of the drawing and start to nail down that head a little bit more. Tilt the head to your left a little bit. Perfect, right there. So I'm going to squint down, look for the light and dark pattern.
Hey, Eric.
You.
Admiral Otuse asks, man, just watching the way you and Jeff handle those charcoal pencils is pretty amazing. I'm still working on transitioning from graphite on 8.5 by 11 paper. It's a tough transition, personally.
Just tell them that my mindset on both is generally the same, but each medium, I guess the short answer is each medium has its own unique dexterity that is acquired through repetition and practice. So whatever proficiency he has with graphite will come with charcoal once he's put in the same number of hours. So, but the knowledge is the same. And then you can shorten that down. Or I guess if he can hear it. Like for instance, I'm still working on developing the dexterity that I have with charcoal and trying to develop that same level with oil paint. I don't feel like I'm as adept at oil painting as I am with the charcoal pencil yet.
Christopher Perez is asking, do you use a medium softness pencil to block everything in?
I use a Conte 1710B. As far as charcoal pencils go, yeah, I guess you'd consider it a medium softness. I just use, mostly I use one pencil in charcoal. I don't really feel the need to have multiple hardnesses like in with graphite, because the charcoal is much more versatile. You can get a very light mark by pushing lightly and get a very dark mark by pushing more darkly, or more hardly, I guess, with a little more pressure, giving more pressure basically. So it just kind of, it's just a more versatile pencil in general. I also use the Wolf Carbon 6B, which is a little bit softer. I may use that, I may not. I don't know, I haven't decided yet. But I've got it there just in case I need it.
Watercolorist 7 is asking, when will you do a painting demo? This is great, by the way.
Whenever Jeff asks me to. I'll do a painting demo at some point. We can even maybe, if people enjoy this enough, maybe we can do something similar. If Yoni's up to it, maybe we can have him try and create the Jack Pierce Frankenstein makeup or something. That might be kind of fun. We can do a live Frankenstein painting. Yeah, I'm up for it whenever. I mean, we've got a lot of great instructors here that will be rotating through doing demos, and they'll all bring something really, really cool and unique to the table. Hopefully, whenever I come in and sit in, I'll do something horror movie driven, because it's what I enjoy, and people seem to enjoy it as well. So.
Nicholas Hoover is asking, are these events open for locals to view at the school?
That's a great question.
Hey Jeff.
What's the question?
People want to know if they can come by and watch.
At this point, I would have to say no.
So I guess not as of yet. Maybe down the road we'll set up something like that, but right now it's live viewings for students.
Stone Monkey 2 is asking, how come you didn't tone the drawing? Are you just good at judging values, or is that not really done at Watts Atelier?
No, I do that at times, and I considered it on this drawing. No particular reason why I chose not to. I just chose not to. I chose to build up the values instead. In fact, I probably will tone it here at some point once I get the big drawing established. I guess I just wanted to be comfortable with the two-value setup of the drawing before I glazed over. Otherwise, if I glaze over and lay in a big tone and then I mess up an area, I just end up erasing through it anyway. But I'm starting to feel pretty comfortable with the two-value of the drawing, so I probably will be laying a tone over the whole drawing here shortly. But I'm certainly not opposed to that process. When I do graphite drawings, I typically will use graphite powder and put a tone over the whole paper before I start drawing.
I just added the link. It's in the description.
Sorry.
You may have to refresh your page in order to see it.
Okay. My chum is asking, are you guys going to be doing demos at San Diego Comic-Con this year?
Yes, we will. I'm not sure of the days and times right off the top of my head, but we'll be posting those at some point, probably in the near future. Okay, we're going to be taking a short break here, and we'll be back in just a few minutes.
Should probably say back in 5 instead of 3.
Yeah, there we go. I'm going to cataract your eyes anyway.
Okay,
so.
Cool. Thank you.
Do you think you can find a timer?
Yeah.
Because I'm going to be taking off soon. kind of see how you're set up.
Seamless edges.
What's like for
the wounds?
For the wounds, yeah.
How
yeah. Many different?
Well, the latex, you know, latex is like a viscous sort of skin color stuff. So, yeah, so you need something like cotton to soak it up and make it different, I think.
Okay.
So, we just have to do layer after layer after layer. Like this, we just mixed it with some A and B compound. And, yeah, yeah. For really stoked.
Okay.
Are you
going to
make the rest of the time?
Yeah. Chin up just a little bit more. There you go, perfect. Okay, so one question I saw during the break that I didn't hadn't responded to yet is someone asked if I was if I hold the pencil and use the pencil the same way when I draw in my sketchbook, and the answer is no. Well, I should say sometimes, but as a standard, no. I hold it. If you're watching, I hold it a little bit more like this, or regular, like a writing utensil. Really, I hold it whichever way I need to get the indication that I want to get. That's the real answer. So, but probably not the one most people want to hear. So, however I need to, whatever position I need to hold the pencil in to get a certain indication, that's how I hold the pencil. It constantly changes.
Klaus Warner is asking, when you shade, do you look out for the direction of the plane with cross-hatching, or is this something you put in later for texture?
A little bit of both. During this phase, I'm looking at plane direction, planar structure of whatever it is that I'm drawing. Later on, I will start using it to add texture as well.
Ari Zablowski is asking, how do you judge proportions? Are all your marks in the right position from the get-go, or do they get adjusted as the drawing continues?
Two-phase question, I suppose. My main way of judging proportion is relative measurement. So I'm constantly comparative measurement. Basically, I'm constantly comparing one thing to another. I'm looking at negative shape, plumb lines, relative proportions. So measuring one thing off of another. And the other answer would be I shoot to get them in the right place right from the get-go, but I'm certainly not perfect, and so it changes and modifies as I go through the drawing. I'm constantly making adjustments as I feel they need to be made. So yeah, I shoot for perfection, but almost never, in fact, never get there. So.
Fluffy dance?
Fluffy dance.
Yeah.
Ams is asking, in relation to measuring, I don't see you holding up the pencil to measure off. Are you mostly eyeballing the relationship between aspects?
Yes. Yeah. I mainly look at it and go, this is roughly the same size as that. But I will measure from time to time. But I try to eyeball as much as possible and rely on my eyes' ability to judge spatial relationships. It's actually, once you have practiced it for a while, you'll be surprised at how well the eye just naturally judges spatial relationships. It's just more a matter of training yourself to listen to it. But yeah, I don't do an immense amount of measuring.
Ray V is asking, when dealing with edge, more specifically edges that are lost in light, for example, the side of Yoni's face closest to the light source, how do you handle tone without creating line?
I just look at the value relationship. I'll look at for instance, when I look at that light against light from my angle, it's actually not washed out. The background is a little bit darker, and so eventually I'll push a value up against that line, and so the line disappears. But I don't have a problem with using line. So I don't feel the need to necessarily completely obliterate any outline. And the hand, if you could kink the wrist a little bit more, and then rotate it outwards the other way. Not quite that much. In between. There you go, perfect.
Your body was in craving mode, right?
Yeah. Asking what draftsmen do you emulate and do you think we should emulate and try to learn from? I guess Jeff and the Watts School are the obvious answers.
That's where I've learned an immense amount from. But as far as who I choose to emulate, I mean, some of my biggest role models just in general would be James Bama, Basil Gogos, Phil Hale, Dean Cornwell, Norman Rockwell. A lot of the usual suspects that most people would recommend. As far as who you should study, you know, that's going to be up to you. I don't know that that's an answer that anyone else can really give you. It's who do you want your work to look like? Whose work do you admire? I've learned an immense amount from watching Jeff draw and paint, and so, you know, he's obviously someone that I've always looked towards to pick up drawing tips from. There's a lot of good artists out there, and so it's whoever you look at and you go, oh man, I really admire that person's work. Well, that's who you should be studying from. As far as good solid draft, never let someone else tell you what to like. The problem is that a lot of artists have very strong personalities. It's difficult to make it as an artist if you don't have strong opinions and a strong personality. So we tend to be kind of outspoken. But just have, you know, stay strong to your own opinions. Have your own strong personality and, you know, accept that that's who they like, but, you know, no one can tell you who you should look up to artistically.
Christopher Perez is asking, are there any key things you keep in mind when drawing hands to give them a more convincing appearance?
Pretty much the same thing that as when I'm drawing anything else. I'm looking at the gesture first and the structure second, and then the lighting comes third. So as I'm looking at them, what I look for is what is the gesture of the overall hand? What's the gesture of the individual fingers? You can go back, thank you. So yeah, that's what I'm looking for, is I'll look at what's the action, what's the gesture of the individual, of the whole hand, but also the individual fingers, and then what's the structure, what's the, basically the mannequinizing, what's the foreshortening, is it coming towards me, is it going away from me, how much is it coming towards me, and then I start to break it down into individual anatomical and shadow shapes, but at first it's getting that gesture, which will bring a life to it, an energy to it, which I think is probably what you're asking about. Don't get too caught up in the anatomy of the hand too early on. Capture the energy and the gesture and the character of it first, just like you would with a figure doing quick sketches.
Can you do a little more annotating while you work?
Yeah. As I'm working through, I'll explain things a little bit more. I'll start adding a little bit more explanation to what I'm doing.
Taking a few minutes pictures of the session.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, for sure.
Just slide that. Well, you have an iPhone.
Yeah. Yeah, no problem.
Thanks.
Just different angles.
Yeah. Maybe get Erik in there, like, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, take a bunch. You got a little brace on each one. It's a little contraction for the clockwork arm. It's a little bit of a little for your fingers.
maybe a little bit to your left with your head. And then upright with the head a little bit more. No, like tilt that way. And then turn a little bit to your left. Your head, just your head. A little bit back to your right, just a hair. Rather perfect.
Ray V is asking, when creating a portrait, especially one with dynamic fabric and features, how do you discern which features to ignore or emphasize? I have issues with trying to draw everything like a photo.
I do that just based off of just personal opinion, just aesthetics. I don't have any particular formula that I follow. Each model and each instance is a little bit different. I basically emphasize what I find interesting and play down what I find boring. Or redesign what I find boring, one or the other. So yeah, that's just a instance by instance. No one specific thing that I always do. I just I pick what I think is cool about each individual model and then exaggerate that a little bit and take what I think is not so cool and play that down or eliminate it if I can.
Richard Neely is asking, how best to utilize uninstructed life drawing sessions for someone new to your school's drawing methods?
Oh, tough question. I guess just try to take what you learn either from the workbooks or the demos from the online class and basically try to watch a video right before you go to the uninstructed session and then try to put that into practice, which is basically how you'd do it if you were here taking live classes, only you wouldn't have to watch a video, you'd have the teacher live there right in front of you. But just basically watch the demo online and then take and try to duplicate that process as much as you can under the constraints of that uninstructed workshop.
Brandon Dennis is asking, Eric and Jeff, if you could go back to the time when you first began to learn to draw, what would you do differently?
Work harder, mostly. I mean, I worked pretty hard, but it took me a while to really learn what working hard was. And that was only learned through experience. You know, I thought I was working hard, and then a couple years later I realized, oh, I can work harder. And a couple years after that, oh, I can work harder. A couple years after that, oh, I can work harder. But it's a little bit like working out, too. You kind of have to build up to that. Mental endurance can be built up just like physical endurance can. And so it's tough to say. I don't know. I guess I would have just grown up a little bit quicker. It has less to do with with art and more to do with just, you know, maturity and growing up and learning what it takes to get good at something. I think that when we're young, we don't really understand how hard you have to work at something to get good at it. But then as you get older and you start to, you know, move into the professional arena and in whatever field, you start to realize, oh man, it takes a lot of work to succeed at anything. So yeah, I guess just I would try to go back and tell myself what it takes to get good and, you know, stop wasting so much time doing things that don't really get you anywhere.
Matthew Colbeck is asking, how's it going, Eric?
hey, Matt, how you doing, man? So now what I'm doing is just starting to go in and start to bring out a little bit more zombification of the model here. We've got a lot of really great makeup going on, and I just wanted to get good structure in there first. But now I feel like I can really start bringing out with some of the nice prosthetic work that they've done, and also enhance things a little bit as well, based off of kind of what I want to see. Or things that would maybe be impractical for him to be wearing while he's up there on stage, like contact lenses and things like that, which we talked a little bit about. Just because he's a zombie, it doesn't change the process. You know, I still have to work big shapes down to small shapes, and most of the things that are going to really make him look like a zombie, I would consider details. And so we're starting to get into some of those details now that we have the big picture established.
Ranjit Johal is asking, how do you determine how much you charge per piece or illustration? And how do you keep track of your jobs for taxes, etc.?
Oh, wow. Okay. Usually the budget for a job is set by the client. As far as commission work, I have just a set commission rate that I quote to people. But if it's a professional job, like for commercial illustration, usually the budget is set by who's doing the hiring. Sometimes there's room for negotiation and you can ask for more or say, hey, I can't do it for that. But for the most part, the job pays what it pays, and the client dictates that to a certain degree. As far as how I keep track of stuff for taxes, I have my paperwork, and I have a folder with all my invoices in it, but also it's the client's job to send you tax paperwork as well. But you still want to keep your own records because you don't always want to trust them, and you want to make sure that that things match up as well. So I have a folder on my computer that has all my invoices in it, and then also I print out those invoices and I keep them just in case my computer crashes or something. I have hard copies of the invoices that I just keep in a big envelope. So I think that answered the whole question. Yeah, I wish I got to dictate what I got paid for jobs, but usually it's the client that dictates that. In fact, I'm always a little bit skeptical when a client asks me, how much do you charge for this? Because what I want to know is what their budget is. So if they ask me how much I charge, that tells me that they're probably trying to get me for less money than what their budget is. So yeah, that always makes me a little nervous.
It's just one of those things where, I mean, these are complementary things we're doing, so, you know, we can't control the fact that we have another workshop going on.
Yeah.
Pardon? Yeah, we're going to get that. Yeah.
Rafael Lucchini is saying, hey, Eric.
Hey, Rafael, how you doing?
Great to see you again, man. Good job on this one. And he has a question. It's, what advice would you give to build a portfolio and approach art directors?
As far as building a portfolio, the biggest recommendation that I would give is put in your portfolio what it is that you want to do. Don't chase a market. If whatever it is that you want to paint, whatever it is that you want to illustrate, do samples for that. Basically, give yourself fake assignments. Pretend you're the art director who's giving yourself a job. I know that sounds weird, but be your own art director and give yourself an assignment that is the job that you want to have, that you want to get, the type of work that you want to do, and do sample pieces. And then beyond that, as far as getting the work, make sure you have at least 8 really good samples, and then start sending them off to the art drops of whatever companies you want to work for, or head out to conventions. Personal appearances or FaceTime is always way more valuable than just, you know, cold dropping in art drops. You can get work that way, but it's way better getting out to conventions and meeting people in person. You're way more likely to get work that way. So those would be my 2 biggest recommendations, is figure out what it is that you want to do, give yourself assignments that will build a portfolio that represents that, and then go and get some face time with the people that hire for that type of work and get your work in front of them. But have good samples, good professional quality samples, and get it in front of the people that hire for that. You know, so for instance, if you want to work in comics, well, probably going to want to go to a comic convention. And if you want to work in publishing, you're probably going to want to hit up the world cons, you know, so on and so forth. So yeah, that would be my biggest recommendation right there. But yeah, I would say don't chase a market. Be authentic to yourself. Otherwise, you're going to end up getting work that you don't really want to do. You won't do your best work because of it. Texture in these little facial wounds, and so I'm trying to create essentially a beveling system so that they look like they're actually have depth to them. So I'm putting a little ridge of skin raised up around it with a little bit of a highlight, putting a little bit of a cast shadow on the inside where the layered up skin is actually casting a shadow down into the wound. For some of you, this might be a little, you know, grosser than than you're interested in, but it's a zombie drawing, so yeah. Basically just building up that edge work just like I would on anything else. Form works in a certain way, and our eye registers forms in a certain way.
Yeah,
Raphael's saying thank you, and he has one more question. Is it a good idea to have an art agent working for you?
Depends on the type of work you want to do. Nowadays, I think in the fantasy or sci-fi or horror illustration arena, it's so easy for art directors to find out about artists that I don't think it's really necessary. If you want to work in ad or editorial work, it might be a little more beneficial. Mainly because a lot of people that, or no, I shouldn't say a lot, but some of the people that do hiring for ad and editorial work aren't into the arts as much. They're usually, you know, designers or publishers, and they go, oh, we need an illustration to go along with this ad. Now, that's certainly not always true, but in many times, you know, they're ad executives, and they oh, we need an artist. And so they'll call up a rep and say, hey, we need an artist that does this type of work. But for, like, you know, gaming work or book cover work, you'll get some of that type of work, some, you know, more fantasy and sci-fi stuff. But more generally speaking, that's kind of those art directors' jobs. And so they don't need to go to a rep as much. You know, all they have to do is, you know, again, go to a convention or open up Spectrum or, you know, go on one of the many art portfolio sites out there or something, and they can find those artists. So I don't think it's as necessary as maybe it would have been at one time. But if you're curious, you know, go and get an art rep and see how it works out for you. I had one for a while, and it was okay, but I wasn't getting the type of work I wanted. I was getting more of that type of work on my own by just going to conventions meeting people directly and not going through a rep, and then I didn't have to give up, you know, 20% of my income either. It wasn't a bad experience, I just felt like, you know, it wasn't really necessary. Now, if you don't want to do the legwork yourself, then it might be beneficial. I don't mind doing the legwork of going out, but I'm also a little bit more of a niche illustrator too, so, you know, I kind of have to go out and find those people. A lot of the people I want to work for probably aren't going to go to an art rep to hire someone, so I might not be the best guy to ask about that. I do have some friends that have an art rep and have had really good results from it. So I think that's up to each person to decide. It works for some people, not for others.
At World War II is asking, Eric, when doing commission work, do you generally use a contract?
Oh, yeah, always. Yeah. I mean, not as much for private commissions, you know, like collectors. But yeah, for commercial work, yeah, always a contract. But for questions of that sort, just go sign up for artpact.com and go and look it up on there. You'll get all the information for that kind of stuff that you want. I mean, a lot of those professional questions, just go check out that website and sign up. It's really reasonable, and you'll get most of the information that you need as far as professional tips and career advice and contracts and things like that, because everyone will give you a slightly different answer because everyone's had slightly different experiences when it comes to those types of things.
Cameron Nilsson is asking, I'd like to know if or how much are you tweaking the facial expressions from what you're actually looking at?
The expression, not much. I am peeling off certain areas of the face. You won't hear that very often. To get a certain effect that pushes a certain expression. But no, he's... Yoni's a great model, so you know I don't really have to change too much, and he's in the makeup they've done is awesome. So you know, obviously I've bulged his eye out a little bit more and cataract it and peeled the lips back off the teeth a little bit, which has pushed certain expression. So it's more just I've enhanced the rot a little bit more than changing the expression, really.
your left a little bit? A bit more? Just a hair more. Perfect right there. Thank you. Timer must have stopped. Give me a break. Thank you.
Thank you.
Alexander to this part. And then this is silicone coffee.
Yeah.
Mixed with red, we call it garlic. Thrift store there. Amazing.
Yeah, you don't have to be shy with thrift store clothes.
That's right.
You don't have to be shy with thrift stores.
That's amazing. It's like $10 for a costume. I mean, and then you put it on with it, but still.
Drop food stains on it and come on.
Your left? Yeah, that looks good. Cool. Yeah. Yeah, that looks good. Okay, so I saw where someone asked what paper I'm drawing on. This is just smooth newsprint. I can't remember the name of the brand right off the top of my head. But it's just smooth newsprint. Any brand will do, really. Pro Art. Yeah, that's the brand. Thank you. Saw another question asking, essentially, how many values do I use? It'll vary, but generally, I try to keep my drawings in the 6 to 10 value range overall. So anywhere in that range is generally pretty good, depending on how complex the setup and how many different local values there are. Meaning just the inherent value of something.
Yeah.
Just going in and starting to try and clarify the shapes a little bit more. Just bring the drawing up to more of a finish. Getting into more detail. Subtler value transitions.
Adwo Tuse is asking, Eric, how do you know when to stop working on a particular area of the drawing?
I'm actually a terrible person to ask about that because I tend to fixate and get tunnel vision. I usually stop when I think it looks good. I probably actually should have stopped on this head a while ago and moved on to the rest of the drawing, because it's looking decent. I think I'm trying to just finish it off so that I don't have to come back to it later. But I tend to fixate quite a bit. I would say that the best habit to get into would be to bring the whole drawing up together. So once you get it to a certain level of finish, move on and bring other stuff up to that same level. But yeah, I'm really bad about that myself. So if you come up with a good answer, you drop me an email and let me know, because I tend to really fixate on areas. My wife sometimes will come home and go, "What'd you get done today?" It's like, that eye. You know, and I spent a whole day painting an eye, so. That's a tough question to answer. Tough question to answer. And mine is when it looks good. That's when I stop working on an area. Sorry, I don't have a better answer for that one.
Christopher Perez wants to know, do you have any suggestions on rendering hair? I have a lot of issues when approaching it.
Think of the big forms first. Almost begin by approaching it like Lego hair. You know, like just as a big mass, and work on getting the shadow pattern and the highlights first, and then add texture later on, mainly along the edges of the shadow pattern and along the highlights. Don't draw individual strands of hair. Look for the big masses, like shadow pattern, moving into halftone, moving into highlight, so on and so forth. That would be my recommendation, and that's how I approach it. I usually try to do as little with hair as I possibly can, because it can become distracting very, very quickly, because of its textural and busy nature. It can detract from what is really important, which is the story you're trying to tell. Usually facial features and expression and body language are much more important to that than, say, the person's hair. So I basically use it just as a framing element to help draw the eye around to where I want it to be. So hopefully that helps you out a little bit. But hair is a challenging one, so if you're having a tough time with that, you're not alone. It's very easy to get carried away and do too much. So I would say practice minimalism with hair. Keep it as simple as you possibly can.
Roger Pister wants to know, what would be the best way to approach somebody to model for you that you find interesting?
Carry around samples of your work that you can show them, and so that they know that you are actually serious about it and not just a creeper. Basically prove to them that you're a serious artist, and that goes a long way. But just be cordial and just tell them who you are and what you're doing and what you're trying to get done, and don't just don't start by saying, "Hey, want to pose naked?" Ask them, tell, inform them that you're an artist and you need a model for a drawing or a painting or an illustration, and ask them if they would be interested. Offering at least a nominal fee is always a good idea as well. That would be my recommendation as far as approaching someone to model for you.
My dad.
Raphael Lucini is asking, do you think that a gym is a good place to search for people to model?
Probably not, but I don't really frequent gyms. I work out at home, so I'm not a big gym guy. Let me ask Yoni, how would you feel about that? Yoni's a big gym guy, so.
I don't know if that's the best place. They want to talk to a few guys and see, you know, what they're doing in life and then go in for that question. But I don't know if that's the best.
I agree with that. That wouldn't be how I would approach people at a gym. That could come off a little, stalkery. getting, you know, if you are someone who frequents a gym and you end up, you know, befriending people, then, you know, that would probably be a better way to go about it, is, you know, become friends first and then, you know, maybe broach that subject later. Because, gyms, I don't know. I know a lot of people are kind of averse to being approached like that at a gym. I think they're there to work out and they've got a task in mind. So, yeah, I would say probably not. That wouldn't be my first choice.
Ari Zablosky wants to know, do you usually draw from the live model and use photo reference for your commissions?
I rarely work from the live model for commissions. I would love to. I think it would be great. It's just not financially feasible to pay a model for the length of time that I would need to spend on an illustration. I have used life drawings before as a reference source after the fact, but that wasn't my goal going in. But usually photo reference. I won't usually use a live model for a commission. Like I said, it would be great. I'd love to, but it's just not financially feasible. Yes on photo reference, no on live model, though I think it would be great. Plus, I use myself for a model quite a bit in my illustrations, just because I'm always available. So, I obviously wouldn't be able to draw for myself from life. So.
Nathan Lowe wants to know, do you have any tips for drawing drapery from the model? What about when you're having to modify or invent drapery in your imagination?
First question, approaching drawing drapery from the live model, keep a loose lay-in to begin with, and then only start to tighten up that drapery when you have a single sitting to work on it, because it will change. And so if you're constantly chasing the drapery, that can become very, very frustrating and lead to a bad experience in drawing. So I'll usually keep a lay-in pretty loose, as I have here. And then once I decide to move on with it, then I will start to focus in on an area at a time during a given 20-minute session. As far as inventing or using drapery for an illustration, yes, I will shoot photo reference to generally guide me, but drapery, I will use layer after layer after layer of tissue paper when I'm crying. No, layers of tissue paper when I'm doing repeated tracings. But drapery is tough. Drapery is very hard. I will constantly revise it as once I get my reference. I use it just strictly as a reference source, and I will do multiple tracings on top of the reference to try and get it exactly the way I want it. Drapery, again, you guys are asking a lot of good questions. You're basically asking me all the things that I hate to draw, because it's just really, really hard and difficult to get right. But mainly it's just you got to put the time in. You know, it's always about that, the sweat equity. Sitting down, getting as good a reference as you can, whether it's a live model, the right live model as we have in this instance, or the right piece of photo reference, and then doing many, many sketches to get it to be as close to what you see in your mind's eye as you can, and then do your final painting at that point. The mistake that a lot of people make is, or in my experience, the mistake that I have made, I should say, I don't know about a lot of people, but the mistake I've made many times and paid for it is rushing into the final painting without fully resolving things or thinking, oh, I've got photo reference, I can, you know, I can paint that. And then you get in, you realize, you know, that a good photo doesn't always make a good painting, and you get yourself in a lot of trouble. So do the legwork, you know, shoot your reference, or if you're working from your imagination, do lots of sketches. Once you become a professional artist, you'll find that probably more of your time is spent doing sketches and developing an idea than doing the actual painting. So, I hope that answers your question. These are great questions, though. Keep them coming. But you're asking a lot of questions that I would like an answer to, and I'll give you the benefit of my experience as much as I can. But usually the answer is a lot of hard work. That's usually the answer to most of these questions. How do you do that? Well, a lot of hard work. How do you do that? Well, a lot of hard work. That's usually the answer to solving most problems. Get in and draw from life as much as you can. That'll help you. That teaches you a lot. Because compared to drawing from life, painting in your studio is... in some ways it's easier. In some ways it can be harder, but... I know I would struggle a lot more in my studio if I haven't put in so much time drawing from life.
G. Castro 3D wants to know, what percentage of your commissions do you use digital media, like Photoshop, versus traditional?
If you mean in the actual finished artwork, I rarely use digital at all anymore, except for, you know, color correction of the final photograph. Occasionally I will do a revision, but I'd say probably less than 1% as far as the final artwork goes. Mainly I use the computer for compositing my photo reference. That's mostly what I use it for. I do most everything else by hand, because that's the way I like to do it. My thumbnails, my color comps, everything I pretty much do by hand. If you're referring to actual production of artwork, I would say less than 1%. And that's usually making a change that's just easier to make digitally, or a change that I don't really want to make to the original. So I want to keep the original painting the way it was and still meet the client's demands. I mainly use it as a tool for photography. I actually use my Photoshop as Photoshop. Not that I have anything against digital painting at all. I think it's great. It's just not for me. I don't enjoy painting on the computer, just personally.
Adwo02se is asking, Eric, what does it mean when a piece you are working on looks fine up close, but becomes awful with distance?
That's usually a value grouping problem. It's what we would call a PC drawing, or spotty drawing, and it usually means that your values aren't grouped very well. And so as you get away from the drawing, it starts falling into little islands of value rather than a mass or a form or a good solid composition. So it can either mean that, again, you haven't done enough sketch work, enough or thumbnails, or you've let that original idea, that original compositional breakdown drift away from you. Both of those are quite common. Happens all the time. It's a struggle that I think every artist goes through as they're working through a piece. That you run that risk constantly. So yeah, that's usually what it means, is that your value organization is either sloppily executed or not well thought out to start with, or not as well thought out as it could be.
James Wu would like to know, what are your thoughts on art college? Is it worth it, the time and money, or about the irrelevant fluff assignments you have to do in your course load?
Let me start by saying that any art school is only going to be as good as the effort that you put into it. But that being said, I think that what most accredited art schools charge for the education is highway robbery, and costs more than going to like Harvard Law School, which is just amazing to me, considering what most artists end up making in their career. But that being said, if you work hard, you can get a good education almost anywhere. So it's, in the end, it's going to be up to you. Me personally, I'm very happy with the path that I took, which was getting a college degree in graphic design, where I learned a technical skill. To how to use the computer programs and how to do graphic design. And then I went to Watts Atelier to learn how to draw and paint. I think that's a much better way to go because I was able to direct my own study. I was able to pick who I took classes with. I was able to pick what classes I took and learn at my own rate for a fraction of the cost. So my biggest recommendation as far as art school would go, if you're just asking me personally, and just realize this is just 100% my personal opinion, I would find a good atelier-style school, like Watts Atelier, for instance, and do the core bulk of your study there. And then on top of that, go and target specific areas of study through workshops, either online or in person, if you have that, if you have access to something like that. And then just get good books and study and draw and work hard, and you'll get what you need. But again, it's going to come down to you more than anything. I used to be a really anti-art school guy, and I think that's I felt that started sending the wrong message. And what the message really is regardless of the amount of money you spend, it doesn't matter. No school is going to give you an education. You have to earn an education. You have to work really hard to get where you want to be. And then once you're there, you have to keep working hard. So the common factor, what I tell my students a lot of times, the one common factor they see amongst every good artist that I've ever met is that they all work really, really hard. That's the only thing. There's no one school that they all went to. There's no one philosophy that they all have. There's no one way of doing things that they all agree on. But they all work really, really hard. So work really, really hard. That's my biggest advice education-wise. How you doing up there? You okay? Just let me know when you need a break. You want to take one? Okay. Okay, we'll go ahead and take a short break. Yeah, that'll be good, too, because that'll allow us to do two more 20-minute sessions.
Thanks for doing that.
Yeah.
So good, Erik.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, really nice. I like that eye. Thanks. That thing's awesome. Yeah, I like the glassiness of it. It looks really good. That's a fun hand, too.
Yeah, that's what I'm going to work on next.
Yeah, that's got to be hard.
Yeah, but we're not going to have many people, so I mean, if
narrated. I should.
If you send it over to me, I feel like there's not much to it. Like, you need to, like, review it for a job.
What's that like?
I'm just going to say, a scene from a horror, classic horror movie, a horror novel, and reimagine it.
Oh,
4 hours.
I mean, I'll flesh it out probably.
I'm not too familiar with this.
Where it starts and where it ends, yeah.
Are you getting the same color as your mattress tonight?
That was all color. Stipple it.
Got the around on for dark edges.
Yeah.
Just sit there and drink and
have a little beer, like, it was definitely tall, like, the size of
it. I should say I have it on camera, just taping on
the side. Kickstarter I just finished.
That's a really good idea. Yeah, I should do it more of a long period. I'll try to get it done in the
classroom. And the bed one, I was to do it right, I started getting a lot of work.
I know. I'm like, okay,
That being said, I'm actually still going to be doing this up for Pat Rothschild's charity.
Yeah, my main screen, my butler, it was brutal.
So I had to make an email.
He said, you love your work, and I'll even let you use like whole games that I'm from your shop.
You know what I don't do? I'll do something.
Great.
And then she started laughing like shit out of it. I said, I'm three sketches. One of them is this test.
Really kind of tired and beat up and all that kind of stuff.
We love it, but we can't have a face looking down on a magazine cover, so can you ever look me up? And we need some more motion. Can you have a cape flowing in the way? I'm like, that's not what it's about. just put ice cream on my pizza. I'm fine with ice cream. Don't put it on my pizza.
Hey,
that could
be good.
No. I just said that live on air.
Hang on, yeah. Still.
Is that
me? Still broadcasting. Is it? I think I'm going to get things that I'm going to do.
Okay, so getting back at it here, a couple questions. One question that was asked was, how do you remain focused during your studies and basically increasing your mileage? How do you draw more? I've never really had a problem with that. I really like learning. I mean, I understand what the question is, and I think I understand the feeling. At this point, I think it was just built up over a long period of time. I find that usually my decreased study has less to do with art and usually more to do with the other things in my life. So sometimes if you're having a tough time continuing to study, it's probably because you need a break, to be honest. Don't feel bad about taking a break and going and doing other things. In fact, it's probably good for you to get out and do other things. There's sort of this movement that I've noticed, especially amongst a lot of young guys, where they brag about pulling all-nighters, and that's great. I mean, it's really good to have a good work ethic, don't get me wrong. I mean, I work pretty hard, and most of my friends, they work really hard, and I just talk about how important it is to work hard, but it's also important to still take care of yourself and live life. You know, if you're putting in 6 to 8 hours a day, man, you're doing a good job. You're putting in good work. If you're not putting in that much time, as far as that, I don't know. I've always loved drawing. My biggest problem is getting started, not keeping going. Once I get started drawing, or painting, it's difficult to get me to stop. That's a bigger problem that I have. But yeah, don't feel this guilt about, you know, it's like, oh man, I only drew 6 hours today. You know, that's a good day. That's a good solid day. You still have to go and, you know, take care of your physical health and, you know, eat good meals and hang out with friends and do all those things. It's part of life. But as far as focusing on your studies, for me, it was always difficult to overcome, I guess fear would be the best word for it, and it was just being afraid to do something that I wasn't good at. I hate not being good at things, and so sitting down and torturing myself by doing something that I'm not good at was really hard for me for a long time. And then I just sort of started making a game out of it and just figuring out ways to get good at something, abstract forms of study. And that's something that Jeff Watts really taught me, is just coming up with clever ways, making a game out of getting better and saying, oh, well, if I do this, then that'll work on this specific thing. Like, for instance, for a while, in Quick Sketch, I would come up with different styles of Quick Sketch every semester that forced me to rely on things that I wasn't good at, as a method of drawing, which sounds kind of insane. You would think you would actually lean on the things that you were good at when you sat down, especially to do a 2-minute drawing, but I actually would take the things that I was good at and say, oh, you can't use that. Kind of like what Robin Williams did for a while with his stand-up act, where he would not let himself tell a joke he'd ever told before. So he would do true improv. He would go up on the stage, and not only would he have to make up things on the fly, but he wouldn't let himself tell a joke that he'd ever told before. And that's basically kind of how I approached Quick Sketch for a time, is just force myself to do something different every single time, every semester. And it worked on a lot of weaknesses. So just turning it into a game is really helpful, just making it sort of, making the challenge itself the fun part, really helped me overcome that. So I hope that that answers that question. But don't worry about it. I mean, just do a reasonable amount of work and constantly target your weaknesses. Try to work smarter, not harder. You need to put in a certain amount of effort to get good, and that's good. But don't fall into that trap of, oh man, I got to stay up all night and study, because that's not a healthy way to live life. And an illustrator's life can, or an artist's life can become unhealthy very, very quickly because of the demands on us, and also because we like what we're doing. You can find yourself spending too much time doing it. So just be careful of that. You know how hard you can work. And if you feel like you're not doing that, well, work harder. Another question I saw was, what does it take to make a living as an illustrator? Is it still a viable career? And the answer is, get really good at drawing. That will help you make a career as an illustrator. Love doing it. That will help you make a career as an illustrator. And is it still a viable career? Yeah, it's still a viable career. I know a great many people that make a living at it, but don't think that it's going to be some game, because it's not. It's hard work. You know, just because it's cool in your mind, it's still a job, and there's still times that it's going to become a job to you, like any other job. You know, there's going to be days that it's great, and there's going to be days that it's not so great. But yeah, if you're smart and you stay focused and you truly love doing it, yeah, you can still make a living as an illustrator. A lot of people do. Just don't be afraid to stand up for yourself. That's an important aspect of it, that's for sure. But yeah, if it's something you want to do, don't ever let someone tell you that you can't do it. Go and try and put your whole heart into it. And don't be afraid to fail. Most of the times failure is just you haven't succeeded yet. I've failed so many times, it's ridiculous. I've been rejected for jobs so many times, you wouldn't even believe how many rejection emails and letters that I've gotten over the years. Starting when I was 18 in high school, I submitted to Marvel Comics for the first time, which was completely ridiculous. But I still have those rejection letters. And I've still never worked for Marvel, but I've worked for just about everybody else in comics at this point. I still have those old rejection letters, and all that means is you just need to keep working. It's not you'll never work, it's just you're not ready to work yet, and there's nothing wrong with that. Just keep improving, keep working hard, keep getting better. But again, good questions. Good questions. It certainly isn't a job like most other jobs, though. You're not going to go and clock in and clock out. It can take its toll at times, because you do care so much about it, or at least I do. I care about the product that I produce. It's very important to me. I've done jobs that I wasn't proud of before, and it eats away at me every single time. So.
Is asking in relation to what you were saying earlier, what are your tips on getting started then? Because I have that same problem.
As far as you're saying getting started studying, starting your day, getting in a routine, I would say, is a big part of it. Just have a routine, and the more you have that routine, it becomes a habit, and you just sort of get started out of habit. But another big one is... just doing something, doing anything. It doesn't have to be anything necessarily important. It doesn't even have to be a job that you're working on that day. It can just be starting off by, the first thing you do in the morning is do a page in your sketchbook. I heard about a guy once, and it's kind of a weird story. I think it's taken a little bit far, but he would have to do a page of sketch in his sketchbook every morning before he allowed himself to do anything, including go to the bathroom. So the first thing he would do when he got up in the morning was he had to do a page in his sketchbook, and that got him going. Every morning he had to do it before he could do anything else, before he could eat breakfast, before he could, you know, use the bathroom, before he could do anything, he had to sit down and do a page in his sketchbook, and that can get you started. Now, I'm not proposing that you go and do that, because again, that's, you know, that can lead to some pretty unhealthy results. But you know, it's things like that. You know, just getting that routine, getting that habit, is a huge part of it. And also, go read the War of Art. That's pretty much what the whole book is about. And that book helped me out immensely. And it's all about the clever and insidious ways that we go about not getting anything productive done. And the guy that wrote the book was actually a lot better at not getting anything done than I could ever be. He was almost neurotic about it, where he would, you know, reorganize his closet by color and things like that. So you can waste time any number of ways. Of course, if you want to be an artist, you're probably a somewhat creative individual. And so you can come up with some pretty creative ways to not get anything done. But routine, I guess, is probably the short answer to that, is start building up a routine for yourself that you sit down and get to work at 9 o'clock because that's what you do. It doesn't matter if you want to. It doesn't matter if you have anything to do. Nothing else matters. You sit down and you start drawing and painting at 9 o'clock because that's what you do at 9 o'clock. You know, you eat breakfast at 10 o'clock because that's what you do every morning. You eat breakfast at 10 o'clock. You stop and have lunch at 1 because that's what you do at 1 o'clock. And just building up that routine for yourself is probably my biggest advice and the biggest thing I would recommend. And stay off the internet. That's another big one. That internet, man, that'll get you every time.
Atwo Otuse wants to know, Eric, do you believe there's a particular prime age to begin getting into the professional world if you intend to make a career out of art?
No, I don't. I think the prime age to get into doing artwork as a living is when your skills are good enough to start doing artwork as a living. That's the perfect age to do it at, whatever that age is. But no, I don't. No, I think if you're 50 and you've always wanted to be an artist and you feel like what you're doing is leading you nowhere and you have the ability to go and do it, you know, but realize it's going to be hard work, you know. if you, you know, if you're 18 and you're right out of high school and you think you want to be an artist for a living, go do it. Again, don't let anyone tell you no. Go do it. And I've seen people do it. So I've seen everything from, you know, from kids, you know, in high school coming and studying with us and becoming a professional artist within a couple years, to people that are 50 that come and they leave their job and they relocate their families and they come here and they study really hard and they get really good and they start working. So no, I don't. I mean, is there a prime age? Obviously, the younger the better. But no, no. If you want to do it, do it. Too many people out there that are unhappy individuals, so try to go and do what makes you happy, but realize that sometimes being happy is still a lot of work. In fact, a lot of times being happy is a lot more work than being unhappy. Easy to be unhappy. You can sit on the couch and be unhappy.
Damien Lagpakan wants to know, is the lighting on the model as intense as your drawing, or is it mostly invention?
If anything, it's more intense. The lighting, if anything, is actually more intense. I almost wish I would have brought a piece of white chalk to go in there and really pop that rim light. So no, actually, if anything, it's more intense. It looks great. It looks really, really awesome. There's somewhere, we posted a link of a photograph of the model, so I'm not sure what that link is, but I think it's in the description of the feed. Yeah, there's a link to the photograph, I'm pretty sure. Oh, thank you. Awesome. Look at that. Asking you shall receive. Because this newsprint isn't quite white. So, got a bit more room to play with.
Ari Zablowski wants to know, how do you make sure you are practicing the right skills in the right way?
How do you make sure? I don't think there's any way to make sure, but the best way is to have a good mentor or role model that's going to help guide you and be honest with you, is the best way. But as long as it's good information, I don't think there's necessarily a bad way to study. And quite often, at least with me, only in retrospect could I tell if I was doing the right thing at the right time. But none of it was ever a waste of time. I always got something out of all of it. So yeah, don't feel like there's one right way to do things. I know, again, you know, cryptic answers sometimes, but have a good role model, someone that you can ask questions of, you know, a teacher or a mentor of some kind that will help to guide you along the path. In fact, I think that's probably the most valuable role that a teacher plays. I tell my students, it's a funny thing for a teacher to say, but I tell my students sometimes that I can't teach you to draw, only you can learn to draw. I can give you the information, I can guide you, but it's up to you to sit down and absorb and practice the information. I can't make you into a good artist. You have to go and learn to be a good artist. So that's probably the best way. But I would say don't put an undue amount of effort into thinking about things like that. If you're really that worried about it, just go get the Loomis books and start on page one and finish when you hit the back cover. And you're not gonna go you're not gonna go too far astray. Is that the best way? Best way, I don't know, but is it a good way? Yeah, you're gonna do all right. Okay. Start with, you know, the figure drawing for all it's worth book, and move on to the head and hands, and move on to creative illustration, and just keep going. Alright, you can go, boy. But yeah, don't worry about it too much. Don't stress yourself out over whether you're studying correctly. Get involved with some sort of a program with good artists and get the right books and just start moving methodically through them.
Okay, so we've got one more sitting to go here. I'll
answer the last of your question, your hand rotated. Yeah, there you go. More like that. And then thumb separated out a little bit more, maybe.
Making you proud of it, yes?
Not trying to, man. Yeah, that's good. Perfect. Perfect. Someone asked, what are my favorite foods? sure, you know, ask me anything, I guess. Favorite food, my favorite food, like, just to eat, period, is the favorite thing I like to eat. Real simple, I'm pretty simple. I like pepperoni pizza and I like hamburgers, so that's my favorite food. As far as what I eat a lot of, more often, I don't eat too much pizza or hamburgers anymore because I'm almost 40 years old, so I try to stay away from that stuff. But what I eat a lot of, I like steamed spinach a lot, and I like sweet potatoes, and I eat a lot of fish and bison. So as far as meat goes, so those are, I guess, my favorite foods. That's what I eat. That's what I eat most often. So. Good question.
Lucas just dropped in to say it's looking nice.
Thanks, Lucas.
Nathan Lowe is asking, what's a dream commission you haven't procured yet, but would like to?
Dream commission, I would say there's two of them. So my two dream commissions that I have not yet gotten to do would be doing a cover for Marvel Comics, preferably Spider-Man or X-Men. And the other one would be doing a cover for Famous Monsters. So those are the two commissions that I'd like to do. So let's start a grassroots campaign. You know, go start bugging those two companies to hire me and give me work. So those would be the two that I haven't gotten to do yet. But I've been pretty fortunate. Most of the stuff that that I've wanted to do, I've actually gotten to do. So.
Atwotusa would like to know, are you ever concerned about smudging work with your fingers or hand?
No. short answer, no. I think it actually adds a texture and a life to the drawing. So no, not really. I can always clean it up if it gets overly smudged. I can always clean it up. But no, not really. I don't concern myself with it too much. These pencils don't smudge that much. So no.
G Gastro 3D would like to know, do you miss working in games / concept art?
No, not really. I think it's great, and I admire a lot of the concept artists out there, and I love looking at concept art. It wasn't for me. The pace of it and the unfinished nature of it compared to illustration I found very frustrating. I enjoyed my time in video games and I learned a lot from it. But for me, I like spending more time on a single piece and seeing it through to completion. I used to get really frustrated when something was going really well and then I had to move on to another project before I felt it was finished. So no, not really. And I'm not really an idea guy. I mean, there's guys out there that are concept artists through and through, and like I said, I'm great admirers of their work and they do awesome stuff. And they just, you know, man, idea after idea after idea after idea. And I'm just not that guy. Like I said, I have to sit down and do sketch after sketch after sketch after sketch after sketch to come up with something good. I lean much more on my finished drawing skills than I do on my idea generation skills. So, no, I admire good concept artists immensely, but nah, it's not my thing.
Christopher Perez wants to know, when did you start drawing?
When did I start? Two answers to that. One is the classic, cheesy, generic answer. I always drew. I don't remember ever not drawing. But I can tell you the first time I actually sat down and set aside time and said, I am going to sit down and draw now. And that was when I was about 10 years old. And I got the X-Men annual drawn by Art Adams, the Asgard Wars X-Men annual. I can't remember what number the annual was, but I'm sure you can find it. It was the Asgard Wars, and I was so taken by his artwork, and still am to this day. Love Art Adams' work. And I wanted to sit down and start and try to figure out how to draw like Art Adams. So 10 years old was the first time I remember sitting down and set aside time and said, this is drawing time. I'm drawing now. But I always drew. Even before that, I always drew. But it was always just kind of, hey, here's some crayons and here's some paper, and might as well draw. But that was the first time I actually, you know, took time to go and find the paper and find the pencils and sit down and draw.
Atwo02se wants to know, Eric, what do you do with your collection of old studies, warm-ups, and drawings?
Many of them I have in one of two places, either in some storage boxes, some acid-free storage boxes, art storage boxes underneath my bed, or in a big flat file that I own. Those are the good ones, which are about, I don't know, one out of every 10 or something like that. Those are the ones I keep. The rest of them end up in the recyclables. I do too many drawings to keep them all, and most of them aren't worth keeping. So many of them end up out in the dumpster or in the recyclable bin. So if you have any last questions, go ahead and fire away, because we're getting ready to wrap it up here, I think.
Castro 3D wants to know, what do you enjoy most about teaching at Watts Atelier?
Seeing the next generation of artists obtain their dreams, and the camaraderie are probably my two favorite things. I really like seeing people work hard and achieve something that they always dreamed of achieving. And I like being able to correspond in person with other really good artists. A lot of artists don't get that opportunity. But here at Watts Atelier, some of my best friends are also just really, really good artists. And I get to hang out with them on a regular basis. So those two things. All right, thanks for joining us. If you have any last questions, you can fire away now, or otherwise I'm going home.
Get a pic of that too. Okay, I gotta turn this one off though. Let me see. There we go.
Yeah, so we'll talk about that over there if you guys are up to it.